Welcome to the Brackley Church's Easter service.
We're excited to have you join us as we sing, pray, and hear about the Easter story.
So do get comfortable and join us now for our first song.
We're going to be singing again together really soon. And we're also going to have readings from the Bible by Ariane, Maisha and Libby. We're also going to have a short talk from Greg, who leads LifeChurch Brackley, and also from Rich, who leads St. Peter's.
Reverend Pat from the Methodist Church will now lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Loving God, when everything was dark and it seemed that the sun would never shine again, your love broke through. Your love was too strong, too wide, too deep for death to hold. The sparks cast by your love dance and spread and burst forth with resurrection light. Gracious God, on this Easter day, we praise you for the light of new life made possible through Jesus. We praise you for the light of new life that shone on the first witness of resurrection. We praise you for the light of new life that continues to shine in our hearts today. We pray that the Easter light of life, hope, and joy will live in us each day, and that we will be bearers of that light into the lives of others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the praise of glory dies, my richest gain I count but loss and poor content on all my pride. Forbidden love that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that charm me most I sacrifice them to
At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell him where you've put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabbian," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to my Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I've seen the Lord," and she said, told them that he said these things to her. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anybody's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they're not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my fingers where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it."
Recently, a young man made an incredible claim. He said that he could ride a scooter just like this, down a slope, hit a ramp, and do a quadruple backflip and land it. Now, the world of professional scooting said that's impossible. Nobody ever done more than two before. Surely it is impossible to do four. They said, look, unless we see it, we will not believe it. So the young man went to the top of the slope. He came zooming down, hit the ramp, one, two, three, four, and landed it. An incredible moment in scooting history. Now you might sit there and think, what on earth is that about? Well, you see, it's an unbelievable moment that he delivered on. And here at Easter, we are celebrating quite possibly one of the most amazing things that has ever happened in human history. The claim that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, from being fully dead to being fully alive. And you may sit there and think, well, unless I see it, unless I saw it, there's no way I would believe that that is true. In the passage we've just had read to us, we meet Thomas. Now, Thomas is a friend of Jesus. He'd spent time with Jesus over a number of years. He'd seen Jesus do incredible things in his life, heal people, calm a storm. He'd heard Jesus make incredible claims that he was God himself, come close to us to show us what God is like. And he'd heard Jesus say that he was going to be killed and rise again. Jesus said these things to show why he had come. You see, we all live as if God is not there. We are all disconnected from a relationship with God. And God loves us and wants us to know him. And Jesus came to die for this rejection of God, to pay the penalty in our place. And to prove that the penalty had been paid, he was going to rise again. That's what he told his friends. But when they saw him die, they thought it was all over. When Thomas came into the room, his friends had said to him, "No, no, Jesus is alive. We saw him die, but he's alive." And he just did not believe them. It's a remarkable thing for them to say. No wonder he didn't believe them. Look what he did say. He says this, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe."
A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Knowing the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hand, reach out your hand and put it into my sides. Stop doubting and believe." Then Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed."
Let's have a think a bit more about Thomas in the Bible story. Remember, he had missed out when all his friends had seen Jesus. And Thomas thought, "I'll only believe it if I see it." Now, I quite like Thomas. He wasn't gullible, was he? He wasn't just going to go with the crowd and believe just because his friends did or his family did. Maybe some of you at home are similar. Maybe you have said to God, "I'll only believe in you when I see you." You're not going to believe in Jesus just because your family do and they want you to. Well, what happened next in the story? A week later, the same thing happens again. Jesus appears to his disciples, even though the door is locked. Except this time, Thomas is there. Now imagine the tension in the room. Is Jesus going to tell Thomas off for not believing? Well, no. He says, "Peace be with you. Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Now, this shows us a couple of things. First, it shows Jesus wasn't some sort of ghost. He had a body that Thomas could touch with his own fingers. Life after death with Jesus is life with a body. Secondly, here is the only world religion where God has scars. He understands our pain. But thirdly, notice how Jesus treats people who doubt. He's so patient, isn't he? So gentle. But in the end, he does say, "Stop doubting and believe." And maybe you sense God is gently challenging you this morning. Stop doubting and believe. Now, of course, Thomas had an unfair advantage on us, being able to see and touch Jesus in the flesh. But don't use that as an excuse. Thomas was a man of science. He wanted empirical evidence. And there's heaps of evidence out there if we'll only look. Read the eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life. That's why they were written. Don't make a judgment until you've looked at the primary sources. Jesus' miracles, his predictions, the empty tomb, the phenomenon of the early church, the corroborating evidence from history. Charles Coulson was an advisor to Richard Nixon when he was president of the United States during the Watergate scandal. Coulson later said this, "I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate proved it to me. How? Because 12 men testified that they'd seen Jesus raised from the dead, then they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Everyone was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured that if it weren't true," he said. "Watergate involved 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they couldn't keep alive for weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely impossible." So are you willing to accept the resurrection if that's where the evidence leads, just as Thomas did? Because Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Stop doubting and believe. What does that look like? Well, verse 28, Thomas said to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." There really are only two choices when it comes to Easter and the resurrection of Jesus. Either it's all made up and just a load of rubbish, or we need to say to Jesus, "My Lord and my God."
Jesus did many other miraculous sights in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in its name.
Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." He saw the living, the resurrected Jesus. And as Rich said, there's plenty of evidence for us to investigate it for ourselves. But so what? So what if Jesus is alive, that he did come back from the dead? What does that mean for you and for me? How does that change our lives now in Brackley? How does it shape how we live and change our future? Well, thankfully, John doesn't leave us there. And the story continues. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Did you hear that? That one word, that incredible word, that offer that John gives us. That we may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Saviour of the world. He is the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life. Life is what is on offer for us today. And I don't just mean breathing in, breathing out type of life. Listen to how Jesus describes the life that is on offer for us. He says that I have come to give life in all its fullness. That's an incredible offer, isn't it? That by believing in Jesus, we'll have life now in all its fullness. Life knowing God and him in relationship with us all day, every day. That brings hope, that brings forgiveness, peace, joy. But even more than that, John tells us that whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. It's been a pretty tough year, hasn't it? One of great sadness for the whole country, for the whole world. And there is great news this Easter, that there is life beyond the grave. It isn't wishful thinking. It isn't a figment of Christians' imagination. Life exists beyond death. Jesus promised it and then proved it. He rose from the dead. So why believe in Jesus this Easter? Why put your trust in him? Why say like Thomas did, my Lord and my God? Because you will receive life. Life in its fullness now, and life that lasts beyond the grave. So the challenge to us today is stop doubting and believe. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the
Well, thanks so much for joining us for this Easter service. We hope you have a really great rest of the day. And do find out more about the Brackley churches if you're interested. Let me lead us in a final prayer of blessing. May God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us the victory, give you peace, hope, and joy this Easter time. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen.